بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. Dear colleagues, we have finished with the series of spinal imaging and we will start inshallah a series, a new series about head and neck imaging. And of course you will know that this particular part in the human body is a difficult part with a lot of anatomic and pathologic details. We will start by one of the important subjects in this sector, which will be the imaging of the vitreous bone. And we'll talk about this topic in two separate talks. One talk will be dedicated for the anatomy, and the second talk will be dedicated for the pathology. Then in order to examine the vitreous bone by CT, and we have the axial and the coronal planes. In the axial images, the patient lies in the supine position. We should have a lateral scanogram, and we specify the scanning area, which will cover the region of the two vitreous bones, which are superimposed on each other in this lateral view. This is the site of the vitreous bone. We start from the base and proceed upward until we finish with the vitreous bones. Then in the coronal plane, the patient is in the prone position, and we localize the site of the vitreous bones, and we start from posterior to anterior. In the axial plane, we start from inferior to superior, and in the coronal plane, we start from posterior to anterior. This is the axial image, and this is the coronal image. The scanning intervals should be at 2 millimeter slice interval, and we select a suitable field of view so that we can include both vitreous bones in the most magnified situation. Don't include the whole skull because you need only to see this part of the vitreous bone. And also in the coronal plane, we focus accurately on the site of the vitreous bone. Then we use the bone and soft tissue window images, and we try as much as we can to ensure the symmetric patient position on the scanning table. The need for contrast injection in the vitreous bone is extremely limited, and we do not usually need to inject the patient with contrast, particularly in the CT scan, but in MRI we may need, because our target in MRI is quite different from our target in the CT scan. And you know that the ear is divided into three major parts: the external ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. The external ear is the ear which is the passage for the sound from outside and until you reach the level of the eardrum. And the middle ear cavity, this one, which contains the ossicles. Then the inner ear, which includes the, of course, the cochlea, the vestibule, the semicircular canals, the nerves, and a lot of details, and we will discuss very soon. Then, starting by the anatomy of the external ear, which is the simplest. You know that the external ear is a canal which is filled with air connected to the outside of the body, and it has two major parts: a cartilaginous portion and a bony portion. The external ear is usually filled with air, and there may be some ear wax inside the external auditory canal. Then the external auditory canal will end by the eardrum. Usually you do not see the eardrum, the drum is seen through the otoscope, and it can be easily evaluated, and we don't need to evaluate the eardrum by CT. But it's important to know that the eardrum is stretched along a bony ridge, which is known as the tympanic annulus, and this part, which is the anterior and the superior part of the tympanic annulus, is known as the scutum, and this is an important structure which is related to the formation of cholesteatoma, as we will discuss in the pathology. Then we go to the middle ear, and the middle ear cavity is containing air, and the main content of the middle ear cavity beside air is the ossicles. And you know we have the three ossicles, the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. Its lateral border is formed by the eardrum, and you know that the middle ear cavity is connected to the vestibule through the oval window, which is blocked by the foot plate of the stapes. Together with the ossicles, we can find some nerves we do not usually see by CT, and also a muscle which is known as the tensor tympani muscle. We do not usually see this muscle by CT or by MRI, but sometimes we are able to see the canal of the tensor tympani muscle, as I will show to you. Then the middle ear cavity is connected to various anatomic structures. It is connected to the nasopharynx through the famous Eustachian tube. It is connected to the mastoid through the adytes ad antrum. It's connected to the vestibule through the oval window, and the middle ear is also connected to the cochlea through the round window. We'll see these anatomic structures. Then, in order to understand the anatomy of the middle ear, we should have an anatomic landmark, and this anatomic landmark is known as the ice cream cone. The ice cream cone is formed by dissection running through the ossicles at the level of the head of the malleus and the body of the incus. Then you will got this appearance on CT images, and you see what is exactly similar to the ice cream. The ice cream itself is formed by the head of the malleus, and the cone is formed by the body and the shorter process of the incus. This is the body, and this is the shorter process, and you see this is the long process of the incus, and this is the handle of the malleus. Then, if you look carefully in the middle ear cavity, this is the middle ear cavity, which is containing air, and you can see the ossicles forming the ice cream cone. This is the head of the malleus, and this is the incus, the body, and the shorter process. Of course, there is a joint between the head of the malleus and the incus, and this joint is known as the incudomalleal joint or the malleo-incudal joint, whatever. Both names are right. Then in the middle ear cavity, it is easy to identify the ice cream cone, which is our anatomic landmark. And here you see the head of the malleus and the body, as well as the shorter process of the incus. We have said that the middle ear cavity is connected to the mastoid antrum through this canal, which is known as the mastoid ad antrum. This narrow canal leads to the largest mastoid air cell, which is known as the mastoid antrum, which is also surrounded by numerous mastoid air cells, as you can see here. Then if you go down from the ice cream cone, at the level of the ice cream cone, you see the head of the malleus and the incus and the incudomalleal joint. If you go down, and you will cut through the handle of the malleus and the longer process of the incus, and you got two dots, and these are the two dots. The anterior one is the handle of the malleus, The posterior one is the long process of the incus. At this level, you are able to see the connection of the middle ear to the nasopharynx through the Eustachian tube, and this is the site of the Eustachian tube. Then this level is a little bit inferior to the level of the ice cream cone. Then if you look carefully here, and you'll see that there are two dots, and the anterior one is the handle of the malleus, the posterior one is the longer process of the incus, and if you follow this, you can easily appreciate the stapes, and this is the stapes which is obstructing the oval window. This is the site of the oval window, which is better evaluated in the coronal images rather than in the axial images, as I will show to you. Then if you look carefully here, you can see what's exactly similar to this animal, to the head of the animal and the anterior limb. And you see, this is the head and this is the mouse. The mouse is formed by the connection of the middle ear to the nasopharynx, which is the Eustachian tube. And if you can see a canal beside the Eustachian tube separated from it by a bony ridge, and this is the canal for tensor tympani muscle. Sometimes you can see it in the scan. Actually, you should see here two dots representing the handle of the malleus and the long process of the incus. But at this level, you are able to see this particular configuration, which is formed of three parts. Two depressions and one elevation. This elevation is known as the tympanic pyramid, and the anterior depression is known as the sinus tympani, while the posterior one is known as the facial recess. Then you see the sinus tympani, which is the site for sinus cholesteatoma, and the facial recess, which is the site where the facial recess is going through the vitreous bone to exit through the stylomastoid foramen, as I will mention in a moment. Then look carefully at this configuration. At the level of the ice cream cone, you are able to see the middle ear cavity filled with air connected to the largest mastoid air cell via the adhesus ad antrum. Inside the middle ear cavity, you can see the ice cream cone formed by the head of the malleus, the incus, and the short process of the incus. In between, you can see the joint, which is known as the incudo malleal joint. If you go a little bit inferior, you will see two dots representing the handle of the malleus, the long process of the incus. You see the connection of the middle ear to the nasopharynx through the Eustachian tube. And you can see two depressions and one elevation. The elevation is the tympanic pyramid. The anterior depression, or the medial one, is the sinus tympani. The lateral one is the facial recess. Then if you go above the ice cream cone, you see nothing. You see air only in the middle ear cavity. And this air is separated from the brain by this bony ridge, which is known as the tegmen tympani. Then the tegmen tympani separates the middle ear cavity from the brain. Above the ice cream cone, there is only air. There is only air. Then if you want to know the middle ear anatomy, you start by the ice cream cone in the middle ear cavity, head of the malleus, incus and the short process, air in the middle ear cavity, adhesus ad antrum connecting the middle ear cavity to the largest mastoid air cell. Then if you go below the ice cream cone, you see two dots representing the handle of the malleus, the longer process of the incus. You can see the Eustachian tube, and you see two depressions and one elevation. The elevation is the tympanic pyramid. The medial depression is the sinus tympani, and the lateral one is the facial recess. If you go above the ice cream cone, you see only air, and this air is separated from the brain through the tegmen tympani. Then we come to the inner ear anatomy, and you know The inner ear is anatomy is more complex. It is formed of the cochlea, the vestibule, these three semicircular canals, the internodentary canal, the cochlear aqueduct, and the vestibular aqueduct. And also we should go through the course of the facial nerve through the vitreous bone. Then, as we have an anatomic landmark for the middle ear, we also have an anatomic landmark for the inner ear. And you know that we have three semicircular canals, and each canal has two names, but we will deal with only one name for each canal. This canal, which is very important, is the horizontal one or the lateral one. The horizontal semicircular canal or the lateral semicircular canal. Then this is the posterior semicircular canal, and this is the superior semicircular canal. Then our anatomic landmark here is the lateral semicircular canal. It lies horizontal, and if you have a section through the middle ear, you have it through the ear, you have the chance to cut the full course of the lateral semicircular canal. And this is the lateral semicircular canal. Of course, you know, you see the canals as well as the cochlea and the vestibule via the fluid inside these bony structures. Then this is the lateral semicircular canal, full course of the lateral semicircular canal. And you know that all the canals open in the vestibule. Then this part will represent the vestibule. This is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the vestibule. Then you can also see that the section will cut part of the posterior semicircular canal. And these two dots represent part of the posterior semicircular canal. If you look carefully here, you will see that our anatomic landmark in the middle ear, which is the ice cream cone, will be at the level of the anatomic landmark in the inner ear, which is the lateral semicircular canal, if you have adjusted the plane of scanning from the start. Then here you can see the ice cream cone, the anatomic landmark of the middle ear, and this is the anatomic landmark of the inner ear. This is the lateral semicircular canal, and it opens in the vestibule. And if you look posteriorly, you can see part of the posterior semicircular canal. You cannot see the whole course of the posterior semicircular canal because it does not lie in the plane of the section. Then if you look here, and we can magnify this, this is the lateral semicircular canal, our anatomic landmark, and this is the vestibule. These two dots represent the part of the posterior semicircular canal. Then, once more, here you can see the middle ear cavity, of course, and you can see the ice cream cone, yes. And you see the adytus ad antrum, you see the mastoid antrum, you see mastoid air cells. You see the lateral semicircular canal, and you see the vestibule, and you see the posterior semicircular canal, and also you can also appreciate the internal auditory canal. Then look carefully once more here, and at this level you can see the ice cream cone, head of the malleus, incus, oncodomalleal joint, middle ear cavity, adytus ad antrum, mastoid antrum. That in the inner ear, you see the lateral semicircular canal, the vestibule, and the part of the posterior semicircular canal. Then what happens if you want to see the superior semicircular canal? You should go up. Then if you go up and you cut the crura of the superior semicircular canal first, then you cut the dome of the canal after that. And then whenever you are cutting the crura, you see two dots, and these two dots represent the foot plates of the superior semicircular canal, and this line represents the dome of the superior semicircular canal. Then, in order to see the cochlea, you can appreciate the relation between the cochlea and our anatomic landmark. Our anatomic landmark is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the cochlea. The uppermost part of the cochlea is seen at the level of the lateral semicircular canal. Then if you look here, and this is the lateral semicircular canal, this is the vestibule, and this is the posterior semicircular canal, and this is the cochlea. and this is the upper part of the cochlea, or let's say that this is the dome of the cochlea. And if you look carefully, this is the internal auditory canal, and you will see a small canal coming from the internal auditory canal to the cochlea, and this is the canal for the cochlear nerve. Then once more, if you look here, this is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the vestibule, and this is the posterior semicircular canal, and this is the dome of the cochlea, and this is the canal for the cochlear nerve, and this is the internal auditory canal. Also, you can appreciate the ice cream cone and the middle ear anatomy. Okay, what happens if you want to see the rest of the cochlea? You should go down. And this is the dome of the cochlea, the canal for the cochlear nerve. Then if you go down and you see this configuration, which represents 1.5 turns of the cochlea. 1.5 turns of the cochlea looks similar a dish with food inside. Then you see this configuration represents 1.5 turns of the cochlea. Then in order to see the basal turn of the cochlea, you go more down, and this is the basal turn of the cochlea ending by a small dot of air, and this is known as the niche of the round window. Then this is the dome of the cochlea, and this is 1.5 turns of the cochlea, and this is the basal turn of the cochlea ending by the niche of the round window. Okay, this is the once more the anatomy of the cochlea. First, identify the anatomic landmark, which is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the vestibule, and look forward and you see the dome of the cochlea. And if you go down and you see 1.5 turns of the cochlea. Then this is the basal turn of the cochlea. It will end by a dot of air, which represents the niche of the round window. Okay, this is the dome of the cochlea, and this is the canal for the cochlear nerve. This is the vestibule, and this is the lateral semicircular canal, posterior semicircular canal, ice cream cone, adytes and antrum, mastoid air cells. If you go down, and this is 1.5 turns of the cochlea, and you see also the two dots representing the handle of the malleus and the long process of the incus. Okay, then if you look here in this particular example, and you see this is our anatomic landmark, which is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the vestibule, and these two dots represents the part of the posterior semicircular canal. Then we have two components we should see, the vestibular aqueduct, and this is the very fine line here, which is located posterior to the posterior semicircular canal. This vestibular aqueduct, its width is about 1.5 millimeter. If the vestibular aqueduct is very wide, as in this example, and this is known as vestibular aqueduct syndrome, which is one of the well-known causes of sensory neural hearing loss. Then look here, and you see this is the vestibule, and this is the lateral semicircular canal. This dot represents part of the posterior semicircular canal, and this is the vestibular aqueduct, which is markedly widened. You know the relation of the jugular bulb to the middle ear cavity, and the jugular bulb in most of the cases is separated from the middle ear cavity by a bony ridge, and this is known as non-dehiscent jugular bulb. But if the jugular bulb is not separated by bone, and this bone is defective or dehiscent, and we call this dehiscent jugular bulb. And this is an example of the dehiscent jugular bulb. This is the jugular fossa, and it is not separated by the bony ridge, which is normally seen in most of the cases. Then we discuss the course of the facial nerve through the vitreous bone. You know that the facial nerve will arise from the brainstem. It will pass through the cerebellopontine angle cistern. Then it will enter the internal auditory canal together with the vestibulocochlear nerve. Then this nerve will exit through the internal auditory canal, As you can see here, this is the internal canal, and this is the exit pathway of the facial nerve. And it is discriminated, of course, from the exit of the cochlear nerve by the presence of the cochlea opposite the cochlear nerve. But here you don't see the cochlea, and this is the nerve which will form this very famous configuration. And you see this very famous configuration, let's say inverted V. And there is an ascending limb and a descending limb and a dome. And this dome represents the site of the ganglion of this nerve, which is known as the geniculate ganglion. This arrow points to the site of the geniculate ganglion, and this is the ascending limb, and this is the descending limb. Once more, this is the internal canal, and this is the canal for the facial nerve, ascending nerve, ascending limb, and descending limb, and this is the site of the geniculate ganglion. You can also appreciate the vestibule, the lateral semicircular canal, the posterior semicircular canal, the dome of the cochlea, ice cream cone, middle ear cavity, adytus ad antrum, mastoid antrum, and the mastoid air cells. And this is the same anatomy I've seen before. This is the ascending limb, the site of the geniculate ganglion, and the descending limb. In order to see the nerves inside the internal canal, you should have an MR examination. Then you see that the nerves are present inside the internal canal, but you cannot discriminate between most of the nerves inside the canal. Actually, you have five nerves inside the internal canal. And these are the cochlear nerve and the facial nerve and two vestibular divisions, the superior and inferior vestibular nerves, and the greater petrosal nerve, which is belonging to the facial nerve. Actually, we see only four nerves, and these nerves can be seen and can be discriminated from each other if you have a sagittal T2 weighted image for the internal canal. Then you will see the canal as a rounded structure filled with CSF of bright signal, and you can identify four nerves. Two are very close to each other, and these are the vestibular divisions, the superior and the inferior vestibular nerves. Then the nerve above is the facial, and the nerve below is the cochlear nerve. And in order to see the nerves inside in the internal canal, you should have the sagittal T2 weighted image for MRI. Then I have said that we should have axial and coronal images. The coronal images are important to see some structures, and these structures are three. The tegment tympani, and you see the anterior tegment in the axial images, but you see the superior tegment in the coronal images. You should remember that any bony ridge separating the ear in the middle ear cavity from the brain is the tegment tympani. And we have two tegment tympani, the anterior one and the superior one. The superior one is easily appreciated in the coronal plane. Then, as I have said before, you can appreciate the site of the oval window more better in the coronal images. You know, the oval window connects the middle ear cavity to the vestibule, and this is the site of the oval window, which is blocked here by the foot plate of the stapes. Then, you know, the facial nerve is coming from the brainstem. It enters the internal canal, then exit through the canal, and it forms the two limbs. Then the descending limb will pass below the lateral semicircular canal. And if you look here, this is the vestibule and this is the cochlea, this is the superior semicircular canal, and this is the lateral semicircular canal. And if you look carefully here, and you can see this is the facial nerve crossing below the lateral semicircular canal to enter the facial recess and then to go outside the skull through the stylomastoid frame. This is the facial nerve canal, and this is the oval window. Then, If you look here and you see that this is the vertical part of the facial nerve after crossing into the facial recess, it exits the skull between the styloid and the demastoid through the stylomastoid frame. And if you look here and you can see that this is the cochlea with the famous configuration. There are two dots above the cochlea, and these are the two limbs of the facial nerve cut in a vertical way. There is one limb which is near to the middle ear and is known as tympanic segment. And the second limb is near to the inner ear and is known as labyrinthine segment. Then these two segments are seen in the axial as inverted V and are seen in the coronal as two dots above the cochlea. Then there are some nerves which can be seen at the cerebellopontine angle. In the era of air cystoscopy, and this is air injected through the lumbar puncture, and you can see this artery or the loop of the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. It is well seen at the mouth of the internal canal, and by MRI you can appreciate the loop also without the need of invasive maneuvers. The importance of this finding is to give some notice for the surgeon that the loop of the artery is very close to the orifice of the internal canal, so that during surgery for let's say cerebellopontine angle acoustic neuromas also, he should be careful about this important vessel. And we came finally to the end of the anatomy, and I will show to you some of the quiz or questions in order to understand the mentioned anatomy. You know that this arrow points to the vestibular aqueduct, which is posterior to the posterior semicircular canal, and this is of course the vestibule, and this is the lateral semicircular canal. This is the head of the malleus, and this is the body and short process of the incus. And this is the geniculate ganglion, this is the internal canal, and this inverted V is the course of the facial nerve through the vitreous bone. This is the internal canal. Then if you look here, and this is the basal turn of the cochlea, and here you can see the connection of the middle ear cavity to the nasopharynx, and this is the Eustachian tube. And if you look carefully here, you can also see the canal for the tensor tympani muscle. And this is the cochlear aqueduct, which is similar to the internal auditory canal, but smaller and inferior to the internal auditory canal. Then this is an axial image, and these two dots, of course, represent the foot blades of the superior semicircular canal. And this is the cochlea, and the two dots above the cochlea in the coronal plane represented the segments of the facial nerve, and this is the labyrinthine segment, and this is of course the tympanic segment of the facial nerve, and this is the cochlea. Then here you can appreciate the vertical part of the facial nerve coming outside the skull through the stylomastoid frame. And in this example, you can see the dish with food inside representing 1.5 turns of the cochlea. And this is the cochlear aqueduct, which is similar to the internal canal, but smaller and inferior. Then you remember that there are two depressions and one elevation. The medial depression is the sinus tympani. And here you can appreciate the 1.5 turns of the cochlea, very good. And this part represents the tegment tympani, which separates the middle ear cavity from the brain. In this axial image, you can see the head of the malleus, and this is the body and the longer process of the incus, and this is the site of the geniculate ganglion, and this is the vestibule. And in this axial image, you can also see the anterior dot represents the handle of the malleus, and the posterior one represents the longer process of the incus, and this is of course 1.5 turns of the cochlea. This coronal image shows the oval window, which is very well presented here, and this is the lateral semicircular canal, and this is the superior semicircular canal, and this is the internal auditory canal, and here is the vestibule. And thank you very much.